Many movies are remembered for their iconic final shots. Planet of the Apes and Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid are two such movies. But fewer films achieve lasting impact and movie immortality with their opening shots. Because it's actually much harder to start indelibly than to finish that way. The Lost Weekend, Billy Wilder's 1945 landmark of serious Hollywood filmmaking, begins with an opening shot of the great city of New York and moves in until it finds all in one shot, a whiskey bottle hidden outside an apartment window on a string. And in that shot, you know everything about the power of drink on the mind of an alcoholic. The opening roll of Star Wars, followed by the immensity of a ship longer than any imagined, tells you visually you are indeed in a new era of filmmaking. The first sequence in Raiders of the Lost Ark can be watched and enjoyed for its own pleasure 1,000 times. But there is, I submit to you, no more iconic and impactful and riveting opening to any film than the beginning of tonight's movie, Patton. A giant American flag fills the screen in a long up-angle lens. Off screen, we hear shuffling and milling about, but we don't see the audience. We are them, watching from their perspective. Then, Ten Hut.
Ten Hut!
And in a deep, long shot rising up comes striding forward a soldier, dressed in almost absurd regalia, ribbons, and a flamboyant array of chess medals. The military trumpet plays to the colors, and he salutes as the camera punches in on pearl-handled revolvers and 4 stars on his helmet. And then this popinjay speaks directly to us. And what does he say? The most profane and unexpected and, let's face it, the coolest opening line in movie history.
I want you to remember that no bastard ever won a war by dying for his country. He won it by making the other poor, dumb bastard die for his country.
And with the immortal obscenity and insight-filled speech that follows, all of the contradictions and paradoxes and love and hate and admiration and revulsion that comprise General George S. Patton and the nation's attitude toward him are revealed. He finishes, turns, and recedes. And the camera has never shown anything but him and the flag. Jerry Goldsmith's classic score rings in, and the biography, often called the greatest American war film, commences, with the audience already firmly in the charismatic grip of a unique and extraordinary protagonist. That opening is not only startlingly original filmmaking, and would still be today, never mind in 1970, it's also, ironically enough, a key to the long, almost endlessly long, even by Hollywood standards, path that tonight's film had to wind to get to the screen. You see, that opening was conceived and written using mostly Patton's own words stitched from various speeches by a young, unknown UCLA film graduate whose name you may recognize, Francis Ford Coppola. Its stylistic audacity and character nuance was the harbinger of a massive new talent, and one who, for his efforts, was promptly fired from the movie. Coppola has said, in wise advice to those starting out, he said, "Not to worry. The things they fire you for when you're young are often the things they give you life achievement awards for when you're old." And in this particular case, the daring approach to the script for Patton that Coppola took, not just in the opening, but in the thematic rendering of a warrior in love with war and out of his time and perhaps out of his mind, would return years later to resurrect his career. But I've gotten ahead of the story a bit, and I need to retreat, something Patton would never contemplate, to the beginning of the story. Hollywood has had a love affair with what we call biopics since the beginning of movies itself. Perhaps the earliest example is Jeanne d'Arc in 1899, French filmmaker Georges Méliès' epic about the life of Joan of Arc. Over the years, Hollywood had a tendency to sanitize these biopics, idolizing their subjects or glossing over unattractive details. And Fox made plenty of our own squeaky clean such biopics, including Song of Bernadette, Young Mr. Lincoln, and the story of Alexander Graham Bell. But Patton, especially as conceived by Coppola, would challenge that status quo and create an entirely different kind of biopic, an unvarnished one with an ambivalent attitude towards its hero, anti-hero. Nor was Patton your typical war picture. Up to that point, patriotic movies like The Desert Rats, Halls of Montezuma, and To the Shores of Tripoli portrayed the glory, but usually avoided the horrors of war. Patton showed realistic battlefield carnage that stunned audiences. And interestingly, that was in part influenced by another war picture Fox was shooting at the same time, Robert Altman's MASH. You see, as studio executives were watching dailies of both films, they complained to Altman that his soldiers looked too dirty compared to the soldiers in Patton. Altman told him that soldiers during war were dirty. And as a result, the producers of Patton were asked to dirty up their soldiers as well. That was the first instance of a point-counterpoint relationship between Patton and MASH, and I'll tell you a lot more about that after the movie. Actually, there were three great war movies from Fox in that same year because Tora, Tora, Tora was also released in 1970. That will not surprise those of you who know that the Daryl Zanuck I've often spoken of on this show was also Colonel Zanuck, United States Army. Daryl F. Zanuck was one of the very few major players in Hollywood's golden age who was not born in Europe. He was as American as the Nebraska hinterlands where he was born. Daryl Francis Zanuck was born in Wahoo, Nebraska, the product of a wretchedly unhappy marriage that left him abandoned by both of his parents by the time he was 13. In 1917, when he was just 15, Zanuck lied about his age and joined the Army. He saw combat in France and Belgium during World War I. His experiences in the First World War would help give Zanuck a special appreciation for and insight into the lives of fighting men, and it would inform his work well into the 1960s. Indeed, months before Pearl Harbor, Zanuck was commissioned as a lieutenant and went on active duty, even though he was already running Fox by that time. In January 1942, Zanuck requested overseas duty. He served, lending his unique expertise born from years in the film industry. He studied battle footage and trained cameramen in combat. On D-Day, Daryl Zanuck landed in Algiers, where he produced a series of combat and training films for what was then known as the War Department. He rose to the rank of colonel and was awarded the Legion of Merit. And in true Hollywood fashion, he used to brag about all this too, emphasizing to everyone that he was above draft age when he went. Well, in North Africa in 1942, he met the man in command of the Western Task Force, General George S. Patton. Two living legends, no doubt, shaking hands somewhere in the African desert. And another man who met Patton at that time was Colonel Frank McCarthy, a man of tremendous military experience, including high-profile positions in the War Department. McCarthy rose to the post of Assistant Secretary of State before transitioning into, what else? The movies. Flash forward post-war to 1951. McCarthy was producing a war picture for Zanuck, Decision Before Dawn. 2 months before that movie released, McCarthy sent a memo to Zanuck suggesting that they create a biopic of their mutual acquaintance, General Patton. Zanuck wrote back, "Get going on it." But the process was far from simple, and there were nearly 20 years between the inception and release. That is one of the longer periods of development hell I have personally ever heard of. It took me 14 years and becoming the head of a studio to get Patrick O'Brien's Master and Commander made into a movie. It took over 40 years for Arthur Miller to get a proper film of The Crucible made. But 20 years is no picnic. These examples, by the way, all speak to the power and rarity of good ideas in movies. When you find one, hang on and don't give up. Keep fighting. In any case, the biggest roadblock to Patton for most of those years was his family. His widow resented the harsh and inaccurate treatment that her husband had endured from the press, something we studio executives can readily identify with, trust me. And she didn't want a movie to further tarnish him. Patton's son, George, went around for years saying he would, quote, shoot any son of a bitch that tried to make a movie about his father, obviously having inherited his father's fondness for profanity. You know, Patton had famously said once that a gentleman should be able to cuss for 3 minutes without repeating himself. So, under threat of a bullet, the project languished for a decade before the family finally relented. As a touching postscript to the family's issues, ironically, they actually loved the final film. Right after the opening, Ruth Ellen Totten, the general's daughter, was scheduled to meet with her attorneys to discuss how best to proceed in a lawsuit against 20th Century Fox. When she did not arrive for the 9 a.m. meeting, the lawyers called. She told them, quote, I saw the film last night, and in the words of my father, call off the dogs, piss on the fire, and tell everyone to go home. A few days later, she wrote, we could not imagine a media as vulgar as the movies giving him any kind of a break at all. We were wrong to this extent. They were more sensitive, more just, and more realistic in their portrayal than any of the contemporary people who portrayed him and judged him. But we were right in this respect, she said. If we had not fought so long and so hard to block the motion picture, they might have made it sooner and then not have had George C. Scott in the title role. By the time permission was finally given, though, it was no longer the rah-rah 1950s. It was now in the heat of the Vietnam War and the burgeoning anti-war movement. A traditional approach to Patton seemed passé, so McCarthy made a very unconventional move. He called UCLA's film department and asked for their most promising graduate student in the hope that a youthful perspective would give the biopic relevance. Enter Coppola and his unconventional, warts and all, portrait of a warrior who genuinely and firmly believed he had lived past lives as a Viking and on a battlefield in Carthage in the 2nd century BC, so thirsty there that he drank his own urine.
2,000 years ago, I was here.
In retrospect, all this is brilliance. But at the time, it was all just too far out for the director attached to the project, the old school master, William Wyler. William Wyler, legendary for Wuthering Heights, Roman Holiday, Best Picture winners, The Best Years of Our Lives, and Ben-Hur. He didn't like Coppola's script. Instead, he had Oscar-winning screenwriter James Webb, best known for How the West Was Won, turn it into a traditional military biopic. And then, over time, Spencer Tracy, Burt Lancaster, Robert Mitchum, Kirk Douglas, Lee Marvin, even John Wayne were considered for the part. But Wyler's choice was Rod Steiger. Oscar nominated for On the Waterfront and The Pawnbroker, Steiger won for his portrayal of a police chief in The Heat of the Night. He was an actor with tremendous presence and power, and he could certainly fill a general's shoes. But Steiger made what he would later admit was the biggest mistake of his life. He passed. Quote, I will not glorify war, he told McCarthy. He later said that if his Patton was half as good as the final product, it would have changed his career entirely, including perhaps giving him enough of a boost to help him land the role in The Godfather that he was up for but didn't get. You see, the movies is often like a little game of dominoes. One decision influences another and another and a slew of others. And so, screening Fox's 1966 film, The Bible, Zanuck pointed to George C. Scott as Abraham and said to McCarthy, there's your Patton. Scott had memorably portrayed a general before, albeit one who was absolutely and totally insane in Stanley Kubrick's 1964 classic, Dr. Strangelove. And there were shades of Patton's feral power and unbridled rage in Scott's memorable performance as Burt Gordon in Fox's The Hustler. There was no doubt he could do the role, but Fox's board of directors didn't see eye to eye with Zanuck on it, thinking that Scott wasn't a big enough star. But with a bit of a rebellious streak himself, Zanuck offered the role of Scott anyway. But guess what? Scott didn't accept immediately. He had issues with Webb's rewrite, feeling that Patton was now too one-dimensional. Scott would only do the role if they went back to Coppola's script. So the wheel of movie fate turned again, and George C. Scott was in, but William Wyler was out. Instead, Franklin J. Schaffner was hired off the strength of the recently released Planet of the Apes. Schaffner was also a Navy man during World War II, so he had his own military experience to draw from. Screenwriter Edmund North, best known for The Day the Earth Stood Still, was brought in. He remained faithful to Coppola's script, but used his own military experience to make the battle scenes a little more historically accurate. And with that, the team was in place and production commenced on February 1, 1969. To me, of all the facts about the movie you're about to see, none is more important than the year of its ultimate creation, 1969. For all the cross currents that were tearing America at that time can be found in the portrait of the poet warrior.
As if through a glass and darkly, the age-old strife I see, where I fought in many guises, many names, but always me. You know who the poet was? Me.
Is it a war film or an anti-war film? I think the answer depends very much on which side of the barricade you were on at that time. For me, and I marched on the Pentagon in 1970, I think it's both. And I'm sure that that is its genius and the reason it will still resonate with you tonight.
30 years from now, when you're sitting around your fireside with your grandson on your knee, and he asks you, what did you do in the great World War II? You won't have to say, well, I shoveled shit in Louisiana. All right, now you sons of bitches, you know how I feel.
All right, now you sons of bitches, you know how I feel. I'll see you after the film. Enjoy. As the Nazi profiler in the movie you just saw suggests, George Patton had nothing to live for after the war ended. Quote, he too will be destroyed. The absence of war will kill him. Patton metaphorically died at the end of World War II, and that's just where the filmmakers wisely ended their story. Ironically enough, though, Patton in fact died 7 months after victory in Europe, due to injuries sustained from a car accident while, oddly enough, pheasant hunting. He was buried alongside soldiers who died during the Battle of the Bulge, his greatest victory. Fox had three war pictures in 1970. Tora, 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 a traditional film about Pearl Harbor, then, of course, Patton, and also MASH. It's hard to imagine the real Patton embracing the counterculture anti-war message of MASH. But in military fashion, the films did battle it out, both in the movie theaters and on the award circuits. They were both smash hits, but MASH outgrossed Patton by the equivalent of about $100 million in today's money. Patton bested MASH at the Oscars, winning 10 Academy nominations and 7 Oscars. Patton beat MASH, Airport, 5 Easy Pieces, and Love Story to win Fox's 6th out of now 10 Academy Awards for Best Picture. And here, our story returns to Mr. Coppola. You see, years after he was let go by Fox, after writing the original draft of the screenplay, he recalled that he was in San Francisco and he got a call from someone at Fox. Fox, you see, had rented editing machines from Coppola's American Zoetrope company and they needed repair. Well, nobody but Coppola knew anything about the equipment, so he went himself. When he arrived in the editing suite, he was surprised to discover they were editing footage of Patton. He had no idea that the project had actually moved forward and gotten made. After finishing the repairs, Coppola packed up his little bag, and as he left, he said, "You know, I wrote that script." And when Francis Ford Coppola won his award for Best Adapted Screenplay, it could not have come at a better time in his life. He was then working on The Godfather and was afraid he was about to get fired by Paramount because the project was in trouble. But how can you fire a guy who just won an Oscar? So he stayed on the project, which ultimately made its own Oscar history. George C. Scott won for Best Actor, an award he famously rejected. He's alleged to have said, "If Brando couldn't win for Streetcar Named Desire, what good is it?" But the more likely truth is, he felt that the campaigning and promoting for Academy Awards was unseemly for actors, and I have to tell you, I agree. And God knows it's far worse today than it was in 1970. I'd much rather the Academy Awards process were insulated from advertising and media manipulation. But then I also wish that money didn't influence politicians and that the tooth fairy was real. Still, it would have been great if old George had shown up, maybe a few sheets to the wind, and given the TV beeper guy a full 3-minute General Patton lesson in artful profanity. But true to his word, he did not. And while legend has it that Scott's award sits uncollected in a warehouse somewhere, I'll give you a little inside scoop. Actually, when an Oscar winner gets their award, it doesn't have their name on it yet. That happens after the ceremony. So if someone decides not to accept it, they simply use the blank trophy for another category. Technically, someone out there has George C. Scott's Oscar, but they never know it. So, a word to the wise. If you ever get the honor of winning an Academy Award, go ahead, pick it up before it gets recycled. George C. Scott died in 1999, never again even approaching the heights of his Patton performance. And Patton died in a damn car crash. It does seem an anticlimactic end to both the fictional character and the larger-than-life actor who inhabited him. Not what any screenwriter or poet or filmmaker or fan would wish for either of them. Better to leave them prancing on the beautiful white horse or roaring to the last row of the balcony. For after all, remember, there is only one proper way for a professional soldier to die, General George S. Patton said, by the last bullet in the last battle in the last war. Well, would that any of us, or our children or theirs, live to see the end of war. And if Patton is reincarnated and present at that devoutly to be wished for moment, I have no doubt he will cry tears of both joy and sorrow. Good night.